Okay. Good morning and welcome to the 28th meeting of 2015. Everyone present is asked to switch off mobile phones and other electronic equipment as they affect the broadcasting system. Some committee members will refer to tablets during the course of the meeting because we provide meeting papers in digital format. We have apologies this morning from Willie Coffey, and I welcome Stuart Stevenson, who is attending in his role as a committee substitute. I also welcome Sandra White MSP, member in charge of a draft bill that we will deal with later. Our first agenda item is to consider the following negative statutory instrument. That's the Energy Performance of Buildings Scotland Amendment Regulations 2015, SSI 2015/386. Members will see from the clerk's note that this instrument is to facilitate wider access to energy performance data. This legislation will not introduce new policy nor lead to any new costs. Members will note that the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee had no comment to make in relation to this instrument. Do members have any comments? Is the committee content to agree it has no recommendations to make to Parliament in relation to this instrument? Agreed. Thank you. We now move on to agenda item two. It's evidence sessions on the Footway Parking and Double Parking Scotland Bill. We have two panels giving evidence. The first will be the Minister for Transport and Islands, and the second will be Sandra White, the member in charge of the bill. For the first panel, I introduce Derek Mackay, Minister for Transport and the Islands, and Sharon Wood, Policy Officer, Asset Management, Finance and Technical Branch, Transport Scotland, Scottish Government. Mr. Mackay, do you wish to make an opening statement, please?
I do. Thanks, Convener. First of all, I can report that we're working on a shorter title for Sharon as well, as the evidence for the committee this morning. So thank you for the invitation to give evidence on the Footway Parking and Double Parking Scotland Bill. Sandra White is undertaking commendable work to develop this bill in a subject area which we all acknowledge is complicated. Parking is subject to various acts and regulations, and the Members' Bill seeks to introduce clear prohibitions whilst allowing for various qualifications and exceptions. Removing obstructions from our pavements to assist vulnerable groups sits well with our key strategic transport policy of improving quality, accessibility and affordability to transport. However, the presiding officer issued a statement explaining that, in her view, the bill is outwith the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament. This statement raised significant doubt as to whether any act flowing from the bill would be fully within the legislative competence of the Parliament. You will also have heard from local authorities about their concerns and operational issues, in particular enforcement. At present, only 14 out of 32 local authorities have decriminalised parking enforcement powers following the removal of traffic wardens in February 2014 from these areas. In non-DPE areas, Police Scotland would still be responsible for enforcing the powers of this bill as part of their wider traffic offences enforcement. But I'm aware that a number of local authorities are considering the introduction of DPE, and my officials will work closely with these local authorities in the development of their applications. You've also heard from some members of the public who have questioned the impact of the bill on roads in built-up areas. Some roads, particularly in the built-up areas, do not necessarily have the space to accommodate the footway parking proposals, with residents potentially required to park cars some distance from their homes and possibly displacing other vehicles in turn. This could give rise to some challenging traffic management issues for road authorities. It is also important that we sensitively acknowledge the town regeneration policies in place so as not to discourage people from shopping in their local towns due to unduly restrictive parking requirements. Overall, new legislation in this area needs to be aimed at both achieving the aims in view and enabling Scotland's roads to continue to function effectively. Having considered the matter fully, I want to advise the committee that the Scottish Government supports the general principles of this bill, which align with our strategic transport policy. But I want to make it clear that should the Parliament agree the general principles of the bill at stage one, the Scottish Government is of the view that no further action should be taken by the Parliament on the bill until the legislative competence issues are resolved. Following agreement with the UK Government, we are working to resolve the issues via the Scotland Bill. The intention is to introduce suitable exceptions to the list of reserved matters in Schedule 5 to the Scotland Act 1998 to remove any doubt about legislative competence in this area. The precise form of the amendments required, it remains under discussion with the UK Government, but it's extremely unlikely that any legislative competence alterations will be enforced before the Scottish Parliament is dissolved in March 2016. Therefore, it is my strong preference that, whilst we work to resolve the legislative competence issues, the focus should now shift to the development of a bill to be taken forward by the Scottish Government in the next parliamentary session, once the issue of legislative competence has been resolved. And of course, Convener, I'll move more quickly if the parliamentary authorities and timetable allows, but that's the timescales that we appear to be working to. So in conclusion, we're supportive of the general principles of the bill, but I am of the view that until legislative competence is resolved, no further action should be taken by the Parliament on the bill. Given the anticipated timescales for that, I believe the appropriate or the most appropriate way forward is for the Scottish Government to progress a bill in the next parliamentary session, but for the time being, we continue to support Sandra White's bill.
Thank you, Minister. Is the lack of legislative competence in this area the reason why there's no Scottish Government memorandum on the Members' Bill?
There should be a memo, certainly, which should have been circulated.
The circulation will... the memorandum will be issued after this committee debate. We had to get clearance of all the comments that was in the memorandum.
That's not particularly useful for this committee, Minister. Normally we would have the memorandum before this, and I wonder why it is that we've had this delay. Is that down to the legislative competence issues?
Can I explore that and come back to you, Convener? I wasn't aware you weren't in possession of a memo that I've cleared.
I would be extremely grateful if you could, Minister, because it's always concerning when the committee doesn't have these details at hand. Can I take you back, Minister, because you said that the government is supportive of the general principles of the bill. So does that mean that the government wants to see this bill go through the stage one process, even though it may not be complete by the end of this parliament because we won't have the legislative competences?
That's broadly correct. I think it's important for parliament to express a view. The government's very interested in the views of the committee. We are supportive of Sandra White in progressing the bill because it's got important principles that I think many members have tried to take forward, and government's keen to progress this. If it were to progress now, the government would seek to amend the bill to make improvements. That would be done, of course, through stage two to stage three. But as it happens, we don't think it'll make that progress because of the legislative competence issues. We are supportive of the principles of the bill. So speaking politically, if the Parliament through committee and then to a stage one debate shows support for the bill, I think that lines up the debate well for whoever may happen to be in government or indeed in the next Parliament to know that this is an important matter that should be taken forward. So we are supportive of the principles, but we would do further work at stage two if it was to reach stage two, but we're being quite open as a government that we don't think it'll be able to make that progress because of the legislative competence issues, and we can only go as fast now as the Westminster parliamentary process will allow. Does that help, Convener?
It helps a little. Do you think that by moving to stage one in this place, it may put pressure on the others to ensure that the legislative competences come here so that we can deal with this issue? Because as you've rightly pointed out, this bill has come before the Parliament in a number of different guises and been put forward by a number of different members. And obviously there are folk out there who have concerns that we've not been able to move on these issues.
Well, that's right, Convener. And as you know, government doesn't share the detail of legal opinion, but because there was doubt around the legal competence of the bill and the presiding officer has set out a position, There has been doubt, but I've been clear since being the Transport Minister of around a year now that we would work with the UK Government to resolve this. UK Government have suggested a way forward through the Scotland Bill. There was a potential of a Section 30 order. We were open-minded, and we could go as fast as the legislative programme would allow once we approve Stage 1. Assuming we do approve Stage 1, it goes before Parliament. And if there's a great deal of political consensus across the parties about this, then I think it would add pressure to the UK Government to legislate. But even if they do it in the fashion that they've suggested, because of the debate that will be had and then commencement, it looks as if that work would happen after the Scottish Parliament, the current Parliament, is dissolved and be commenced by this summer. So if they move more quickly, we can respond more quickly. Officials have been in dialogue, but I've confirmed with the Secretary of State that we are content with the approach that he will take to remove all doubt about legislative competence.
Thank you. Stuart Stevenson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Recognising that the presiding officer's statement that the bill as laid is not within the powers of the Parliament, it may be worth noting, of course, that there is no way in which the presiding officer can give a further opinion in the processes of the Parliament, neither in circumstances where something was competent initially but was amended at stage two or three to be not competent, nor in this case if it were to be amended to become competent. And in the light of that absence of a revisiting the presiding officer's decision, has the government a view as to how Parliament might be informed as to whether an amended bill was subsequently competent or not? And that's quite independent of whether the powers become available or not. The issue of competence and Parliament having a view on that would remain.
I think that I've set out a course of action that helps address the legal issues. Of course, if we ask two or three lawyers for opinion, you'll probably get at least two or three different opinions, and not all legal opinion is consistent on this subject, it is fair to say. But for the avoidance of doubt, because we're talking about issues of fines, financial penalties potentially, a criminality potentially, I think it's quite important that all doubt is removed. So opinion can be offered, but I think the clearest way to progress is have absolute legislative competence beyond all doubt, and therefore we can proceed, and the UK government, Scottish parliaments in the same place on this issue, and that would resolve any concerns that the presiding officer may happen to have. Again, I'm sure your legal advisers are better placed than me. It's perfectly competent to have this debate and for it to make progress through Parliament, but ultimately I don't think it could be satisfactorily concluded through the legislative process without having that clarity. Convener, can I re-emphasise the point, because this is the first time it has been said publicly, that I'm giving a commitment from this government that if we are re-elected, we will legislate on this area. But what I'm also doing is working on a cross-party basis to flag up to everyone that I think if we have got consensus in Parliament, any incoming government may wish to legislate in this area. And that's why this Stage 1 debate and the committee's work is very important, because even if we can't proceed, I think it's lining up the debate very well for early legislation in the next Parliament.
Sandra, is it on the legislative competence issue? I'll take you in then, just
thanks,
now.
Thank you very much. Just to pick up on what the Minister had said, within the group that I was talking to, we actually looked at, commissioned two legal advice from two different legal firms, and they came back and said we had the competence in the Parliament, and I proceeded in that manner. So, yeah, it was a bit of a blow to get the letter from the presiding officer, but I was informed that there could be a challenge if it wasn't seen legally competent by the Parliament's lawyers. So we did have two pieces of separate legal advice that said it was competent.
Okay, thank you. Does anybody else want to come in on legislative competence at this moment in time? No? John Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Can we want to try and move this on a bit and debate the bill that as presented? During the evidence session last week, we heard the evidence from a representative of South Lanarkshire Council who implied that the current legislation that is in place could deal with many of the issues that the bill tries to cover. What would be your opinion on that view, Minister?
Let me be frank. It depends who you speak to. Some police officers would say it's an offence. Some would say it's not worth pursuing. Police Scotland have a position that elements can be enforced. For example, it's already illegal to drive on the footway, not necessarily to park on the footway, but how does the vehicle get there if it's not to drive on the footway? So I think there are areas maybe require clarification, and if we are clear in the bill about what we're talking about, then I think it resolves it. So there are matters of opinion and doubt, and this would help clarify that, and also the issue around some matters of legislation resting with Westminster and some sitting more comfortably with the Scottish Parliament. Of course, we would like all relevant legislation to sit. So sometimes it's a matter of opinion. Now, not all of that's totally resolved, of course, through the proposed legislation, because there'll still be exemptions and there'll still be reasonableness being deployed. But I think that's appropriate, because some of this is quite subjective. But I think it will give us legislative clarity that certain things are unacceptable around so the provisions of parking and drop curbs or double parking, and how parking on the footway is prohibited. We'll also need to be very clear around definitions as well, because people's understanding of the carriageway might be different from the footway or the pavement and all the other definitions. So I suppose the answer to Mr. Wilson's question is it brings more clarity to what is already a complex area.
John? Can I say, Minister, the evidence we heard from Police Scotland last week actually compounded the problem by the description of where the police would actually enforce parking regulations and the series of hoops they would have to go through to get there to actually have a prosecution. Whereas, the witness from South Lanarkshire Council said that they introduced three notices and they were able to take action almost immediately once they'd actually introduced those. So it's really trying to look at, and I welcome you admit there is some legislation in place. It's about the interpretation of the current legislation and how we use that current legislation. Surely that could help resolve many of the issues that are identified in the bill without actually going for additional legislation.
Minister? I know, I think that legislation and more focused legislation, and as I indicated earlier, I would want to refine some of the language in the bill if it was to proceed, will bring greater clarity. And in any event, we would intend to bring forward guidance to assist anyway. And to progress this, I'd want to do more work with local authorities. I covered in my opening statement the issue around decriminalised parking. So I think we have to address the issue of consistency across the country, enforceability, workability, and I would commission more work around that. And in the member's bill, it also covers the issue of commencement period and a run-in time as well. So I think there are issues of operation that would have to be addressed, and some of that would be covered by guidance. And I'd want to ensure, although there's local variations and local exemptions, but I think we need to do more work with local authorities and indeed Police Scotland on the subject before it was implemented. But I think we're some way off from that.
I welcome the indication that you'd want to issue guidance to local authorities. One of the examples I used last week is when you have two local authority towns almost sitting side by side, say in my own area, Motherwell and Hamilton. In terms of North Lanarkshire, they don't have any traffic wardens. In South Lanarkshire, they do have traffic wardens. So therefore, in relation to the implementation of any legislation or any guidance that's issued by the Scottish Government, how would you ensure that was being dealt with across the board equally? Because at the present moment, we have traffic wardens in one authority, none in the other, yet somebody driving five minutes down the road could find themselves in a different regime in relation to parking.
Minister? Well, indeed, I think that's more for the member in charge to consider as part of the current bill. What I'm saying is there would have to be a degree of standardisation of message, because there need to be an educational campaign, clarity around guidance so that it can be properly enforced. How it's enforced across the country will differ because of decriminalised parking in some areas, police action in other areas, and the level of priority that may be attached by a local authority will depend from one to another as well. So I think there's a lot of issues around the variability of it. And then, of course, we come to the issue of our streets are all different. Are two streets exactly the same in Scotland? Probably not. The size of the footway to the carriageway and, you know, what's appropriate, what's reasonable. So I think there's a lot in how any legislation would be deployed. That needs further work. That needs further consideration before adequate guidance could be published, and that would be based on definition. So a degree of variation would be acceptable in applying the legislation to the most local level, but also has to be a degree of consistency and fairness, and that's around reasonableness. Now, to assist the public, arguably there would need to be signage or some other indication of where the law is enforced, and again, that requires further consideration as to how it would work. As I say again, if the bill was to proceed, or if the government was to legislate, I would need to do further work through officials with COSLA and other local authorities to ensure that it's workable across the country. What I'm keen to express at the moment is that, in principle, I do believe that legislation is required.
Thank you. Cameron Buchanan, please.
Thank you very much, Minister. During the oral evidence, the Society of Chief Officers of Transportation in Scotland argued that a definition of all roads with a speed limit of 30 miles an hour or less would be more appropriate. This is to go that we shouldn't have the A and B roads should be excluded. What is your opinion on that, and why would they be excluded, A and B roads?
Minister?
Oh, I'm afraid that's a matter for the member in charge. As I say, I'm happy to look at the detail as it progresses. It's primarily a local matter for local roads. This mainly affects, and Sandra White can explain her intent further, but mainly affects residential and local areas more than, for example, strategic roads. So I wouldn't want to get into that definition other than the broad support. But I think the consultation, and I think this consultation actually got more responses than most members' bill, which is a good and healthy sign, and various opinions expressed. But as I say, that definition would be a matter for the member in charge, and I'm happy to return to it. But this is more so a local roads issue rather than strategic, and I won't get into definitions at this stage.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Stuart Stevenson, please.
The Minister may have caught the feet from me because I was going to ask him about some of the definitions, because I think there are some areas where I'm not clear what is meant. For example, and I will ask the member in charge if I am permitted to do so, I'm not unclear as to what a vehicle is, for example, which is referred in section 2.1, the definitions provided in the interpretation only refer to a motor vehicle, and section 136 of the 1984 Road Traffic Act. And I'm not clear if they're the same thing or not. I'll just give the three. I'm also not clear what parking is. There is no clear definition, and there's nothing referring across. And I'm unclear what stopping is. And the stopping one is important because, of course, vehicles will, in moving traffic in congested areas, will be stopping and starting all the time. And it's clear, I think, natural consideration of the matter that one type of stopping is not going to be prohibited, but other types of stopping might not be. And I just wondered if the government were to pick this up, whether they would agree that these are perhaps three, if not all, the areas of definition that further consideration might have to be given to.
Minister.
Convener, I'd agree with the point, and with the best will in the world, how people have written up notes and lobbying positions and correspondence and common understanding of much of the definition varies. So if we were to proceed, I think we need a common understanding of all the definitions for the reason that members have given. And I think I alluded to that in my statement and other comments as well, that if we were to proceed, we'd want a common understanding of definitions. And I'm sure the solicitors would all work together to give us that common understanding, and then we can stick to it. As I say, I'm very mindful of my time. I have a being a councillor, like many members of the committee, if we know the difference between the footway and the roadway as it relates to the overall pavement, but that's not necessarily consistently understood by all. And then all the other definitions are very important for the enforceability of the legislation, and that is something I'd want to refine further if it were to progress. Again, matters for the member in charge, but I'm certainly comfortable with the principle of what we're trying to achieve.
Just for the record, within motor vehicle definition, I've got a wee issue about pedestrian-controlled motor vehicles, mm-hmm. in particular street cleaning equipment, as to whether that would be allowed to be parked or not, and even non-motor vehicles, like, in particular, four-wheeled wheelbarrows, which have no motor. Mm-hmm. So I think there's a whole series of issues.
To respond to that?
Only to say, convener, at this stage in the debate, I don't want to get into a discussion with all people, with anyone, but particularly with Mr. Stevenson on definitions and technical definitions of each element of the bill. I think if it's of assistance, we could produce our list of definitions as they relate to the bill, if that would assist the committee, and maybe that would be the basis for consistency. But members are absolutely right. You have to be clear on what we're legislating for and be consistent around that.
We're always glad to have Mr. Stevenson. Some would call it pedantry, but I would say attention to detail at the committee. Cara Hilton, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Minister. I'm just interested more in the Scottish Government's view on the sort of balance that needs to be struck between the rights of pedestrians, the rights of motorists and the rights of car owners. We had quite a lot of discussion in the committee last week about the provision of alternative parking for car owners who live in or work in areas affected by the bill. And I'm thinking in particular of people that live in possibly council estates or new build estates where there's either no parking at all or driveways simply aren't big enough and residents have got no option to park on the pavement. So what is the government's sort of view on that situation?
Minister?
I don't have a specified formula other than to point to the designing streets policy, which is a very good planning policy that I was more familiar with when I was the local government planning minister. And new builds, there's a specified design that's more about good design. So there isn't a magic formula that says, well, how close should your home should you get to park? But I think you're absolutely right. The member's absolutely right around the Balancing Act. And it's about being reasonable. So if you take a layperson's point of view, is it reasonable for someone to totally park on the footway, totally block that for other pedestrians, wheelchair users or anyone else? No, it's not. And you know, it's hard to find an excuse for someone to do that, even just for, particularly for convenience to their own domestic property. So it is a balancing act, and much of this would come out in guidance. If there was the prohibition and exemptions, it would specify what areas are acceptable and what areas are not. To get the balance right that Cara Hilton was touching upon, that it will be about a balance. You know, every street is different, and therefore there has to be that reasonable approach. And in some cases, it will be obvious if parking on the foot was totally inappropriate, and the type of parking would be inappropriate as well if it's blocked pedestrian access or other accessible access as well. Whilst acknowledging the point that some streets, some parts of the country, it's impossible to have alternative parking provision, and the displacement in itself might compound other problems. So it is about balance. So whilst accepting that point, there's the clear message around those who choose to indiscriminately park in an unreasonable way to the extent that's blocking the access of people who should have the right to walk along their footway. Does that assist?
Yeah, that's very helpful. Thank you.
Anything else, Cara?
No, I'm just pleased the Minister alluded to the design and street strategy. That's something else that we picked on last week. Would the Minister agree that more needs to be done at the planning stage to build in that type of thing into housing developments? Because, okay, that advice is in place, but when I live in a new build development myself, and simply there is no parking, and that's replicated right across the country. So do you agree that more action needs to be taken to build it in at the planning stage?
Well, I do, and it was fine when I left it as planning minister, and I don't know what's happened since, frankly. Don't report that back to Mr. Neil. who's probably watching.
Watching this, I may have some questions later.
At the moment, such policies are a material consideration and in the planning system, and that's as it should be. And of course, accessibility, active travel, and pedestrian priority in the hierarchy are all principles and priorities that we would encourage. But yes, in a new build, I think we have to be very mindful of this. It's very hard to retrofit existing communities with these new policies, but still we've got to get the balance right because it is impacting on the accessibility.
Before we move off of that point, Minister, are you aware, I know it's not in your portfolio, but are you aware whether or not the planning review panel are looking at issues such as designing streets?
I'm not aware, but I would suspect if it's a root and branch review, and that's how the Cabinet Secretary's described it, I'm sure it could touch upon that.
It may well be something that the committee wants to bring to the attention of the panel, but we'll get to that point later, I'm sure. Sandra White, please.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for the comments, Minister. Picking up on Carol Hilton and the displaced cars, would you, if the bill goes through stage two, stage three, perhaps the government look at guidance to local communities working with access panels and local community panels for guidance on the face of the bill in regards to displace of cars, you know, basically not being able to park on pavement and guiding them where they could park?
Absolutely. I think, and the guidance would come in stages, so there would be the national guidance around how the policy should be implemented. And then I think, as Sandra White's described, when decisions are being implemented about how the law should apply at the most local level, what streets are affected, where do the exemptions exist, I think full community participation would be absolutely vital at that point to get the decisions right. This isn't like setting a national speed limit or setting a national law that applies consistently across the country with that broad brush approach. It has to be very local to the circumstances, and I think all members appreciate that, so that it's appropriate, it's reasonable, and it's sensitive to the local area. And to get the right decision, I don't think you could just have a roads engineer and a planner sitting in a room listing the streets where it applies. I think there'd have to be proper community engagement, and I think that would feature very strongly in guidance. So that it's a, how's it described? I'm sure I've got a note here that says it would be an iterative process. Convener?
An iterative process.
An iterative.
Can I ask you, Minister, you said at the beginning of this that if it was brought forward by government or if it reached stage two, government would have amendments. Could you give us an indication of some of the areas that we've maybe not covered yet where you would say that amendment would have to take place?
So in the members' consultation and in your evidence session so far, and you've been able to provide information about that, there are issues around the workability, the practicalities, the driver education, all of those matters. I want to be reassured as a Transport Minister that they're all addressed, and that's the terminology as well. And I just want to make sure that we have all of that refined should we come to stage two. I would need further engagement with local authorities as well. Although there's a collective opinion, individual local authorities have raised concerns as well. So I think I'd want to capture what are the criticisms of the bill and try and address that through refinement, and that's around consistency, education, the reasonableness, what would the guidance look like, and see what requires to be legislated for and what's more appropriate to guidance. And so I don't have any stage two amendments at the moment because we're not at stage two, but I would be quite comprehensive ensuring that the bill is refined to a point where there's absolute confidence in it going forward. People don't need to be alarmed that suddenly they can't park to anywhere close to their homes, and that's why a bit clearer around what the exemptions and the local situation would look like. So it's, Convener, as you would expect, it's a listening government, recognising that if we are supporting the legislation, that it's refined in a way that your evidence gathering sessions would expect.
And in terms of the financial memorandum that accompanies the current draft bill, what do you have to say about that, and how do you think that that may need to change with some of the things that you envisage?
Some things are difficult to quantify, and we've had experience of that before because we don't fully know the level at which it would be enforced at a local level, or say in 2 years' time how many more local authorities might have gone for decriminalised parking. So I think there's unknown factors at the moment. I'd want a fuller understanding of that. And I know that a number of respondents complained about lack of resources to proceed with this, and that's something I'd want a deeper understanding of as well. Every year, as you're aware, convener, the negotiating body for local government, Cllr, discusses finances with the Scottish Government, reaching a financial settlement. The Scottish Government's got a practice of fully funding any new legislative burden on local authorities. So I think that that's a discussion that would have to be had as well.
Does anyone else have any other questions? I've got one. John?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Just to come back to the issue about drop curbs, Minister. The issue that came up last week was from some of the disability organisations, was that in the definition that one of the witnesses gave was a technical crossing point, which had been instituted in the streetscaping. And the concern was that at the present moment, there doesn't seem to be anything in any legislation or any regulation in place to protect where a dropped curb has taken place to allow access for wheelchair users and electric chair users to cross the road, and whether or not the Scottish Government and its powers could advise or give guidance to local authorities where streetscaping has taken place and the instituted drop curbs for access issues, that the guidance could be given to the local authorities to say that it should be putting some enforcement in at the present moment to ensure these drop curbs are protected for those vehicle users, and I'm talking about wheelchair users and electric chair users, to be able to cross the roads.
Minister?
I'm not sure what the question was. I get the point, and if the point is that we need more work on this, I would agree, because some drop curbs have been put in by private individuals, some of them have been put in by the local authority, and there's different standards that have been used. Some are very formalised, very clear. Some are more ad hoc, random, maybe not of a quality you'd expect. And then there is a question, should that be enforced as well? So I think this point needs further work around that in terms of definition and understanding.
Right, thank you.
Okay. Minister, obviously it will have come as a bit of a surprise to some what you've had to say today about supporting stage one in principle. But giving a commitment that if the current government is re-elected, the competences, of course, come over, that you will deal with it at that point. Can I ask what message you would have to the many campaigners who are out there who have real concerns about this and have had for a number of years and who have waited a fair amount of time to try and get some solution?
Well, thanks for the opportunity to say that, Convener. The only reason, and I don't make it as a partisan point, and I think opposition members appreciate that, I can't speak for Parliament, I can only speak for Government. And that's why I say the Government will give a commitment to legislate on this if we're not able to do so in this current term. If we are able to do so in this current term, and I've outlined why that seems unlikely because of the parliamentary timetable, this Government would be supportive in addressing the issues that have to be addressed, and supporting Sandra White's bill. If the bill isn't able to be progressed, then for the first time I say public, this government, if re-elected, will legislate because this needs to be done. And it also needs to be done in a way that inspires confidence and compliance and clarity. And that's why I'll undertake work and commission Transport Scotland to do the necessary work and liaise with local government to improve this accessibility agenda. And I think it's very important for our active travel priorities around walking and cycling and the accessibility agenda as well to ensure fairness. Now, I know that some campaigners might be disappointed that there hasn't been legislation passed in successive sessions of the Scottish Parliament, but never before has there been a commitment from government to legislate in this area if the Members' Bill fails, which we will support. And I've acknowledged there are some issues of how it would operate and what the guidance and definitions might look like. But if the Parliament and this committee agrees this is something we should do, then we can make it happen. And if the committee's agreed to let it proceed, and it will report to the Chamber, of course, and we'll have a stage one debate, I would like to see a consensus that this is an area that Parliament can work together on, and we'll have the government's absolute support. I wish the timescales had gone more quickly. We've been working with UK government to ensure that there was legislative competence. I'm not making a criticism of the UK government. We're working in partnership to try and address these legislative competence issues. But there is divided legal opinion whether we could have competently legislated in this area. But if we could, we would have been able to proceed. As there is doubt, and as I say, because this affects matters of financial penalties or potential criminality, I think it's important that all doubt is removed. And hopefully we can inspire confidence that people may have waited a long time for the necessary legislation, but this government is supportive of that legislation to ensure that our footways and our roadways are made even safer.
Thank you, Minister. I thank you on behalf of the committee for giving evidence this morning. Could you please ensure that we get the memorandum as soon as possible, please? I suspend for a couple of minutes for a change of witnesses. Okay. As I mentioned earlier, we now move on to our second panel of witnesses. I welcome Sandra White MSP, the member in charge of the bill, and Professor Tom Rye, Director of Transport Research Institute at Edinburgh Napier University. Ms White, do you want to make an opening statement, particularly after what you've heard this morning?
I would like to make an open statement, Convener, and thank you very much. And I want to thank the committee for giving me the opportunity to come here and give evidence on what I think and others is a very, very important issue. I want to thank the many groups and individuals who have contacted myself and took part in the consultation also. And a very special thanks, I think, should go to clerks and staff who have worked so hard to get to this actual point at the stage one of the proposed bill and processing it. I know the committee is aware of the history of the bill, so I'm not going to go into the full history of it. Suffice to say, it started in October 2010 by Ross Finney, MSP, and in March 2012 it was taken up by Joe Fitzpatrick, MSP, and it now lies with myself as a mover of the proposed bill. It was mentioned by the Minister that this proposed bill received 414 basically people writing in responses, one of the highest of any proposed member's bill, and 95% of the responses said they wanted the bill to progress. The intentions of the bill, and it always has been my intention, it's not basically to be punitive, it's to have guidance and it's to have education into allowing people freedom of movement, basically to allow people equal rights of movement, simply to go on with their life the way you and I can, and in some cases obviously even fit and able-bodied persons can't get along pavements, they have to go onto roads, which I find is very dangerous, and others will find too. The Minister mentioned, and I think it's mentioned also in some of the evidence taken about street furniture. In my own area of Kelvin constituency, the council has put in bollards, they have put in trees, they have put in street furniture, but if anyone wants to go along and see the situation there, cars are actually knocking over bollards, they're knocking over trees, they're parked in between bollards, and you just can't move about at all on the pavements. That's what it's like for me and others. Think what it must be like for elderly people, infirm people, people in wheelchairs, parents with children in buggies, blind people. It's not only very dangerous, but it also leads to isolation. And I'll finish on this point, Convener. I'm a member of the Equal Opportunities Committee. We just did an inquiry into loneliness and isolation. And there's a direct correlation with people being stuck in their houses, not being able to get about, with the actual detrimental effect it has on their physical and mental health. This bill is about educating. It's about equal rights, human rights for everyone in the constituency and in Scotland and throughout to basically have freedom of movement. So I'll leave it at that, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Obviously, you heard what the Minister had to say to the committee earlier. He seemed to indicate that it would be best to deal with stage one and agree the bill in principle, even if there is no further movement during this term. Would you agree with that, and do you think that that may give some consolation to those folks who have campaigned hard to get some of these matters resolved?
I would agree with that. I mean, I certainly wouldn't disagree to moving it on to stage one and having the debate in the Parliament, and obviously what the Minister has said about taking this up if we don't have time in this parliamentary session. But he did mention the fact that if things moved on quicker, they would progress with it. So I would be looking to things moving on quicker, if at all possible, and progressing with the bill. If they're not able to move on with the Section 30 and speaking to the UK government also through the Scotland bill, then absolutely more than happy to support the fact that at stage one, agree the principles and pick it up when we come back in the new session.
If I can move on to the draft bill as is, we had evidence last week, and also we had discussion round about some of the exclusions, and the draft bill would exclude most A and B roads and private roads due to the definitions that you have put in. From my own perspective, and I'm going to be slightly parochial and I hope folk will forgive me, Aberdeen is somewhat different in the fact that A roads go through the city at this moment in time, and some of the worst problems that there are in terms of footway parking are on those A roads. Great Northern Road within
my own constituency, and Great Northern Road leading to Auchmill Road in Mark MacDonald's constituency. Do you think that in hindsight you should have included A and B roads and private roads in the draft bill? And do you think that if we move forward that these roads should be included in any legislation?
I do think they should be included in any legislation, and perhaps it was an omission of mine when you're looking at the whole area, that you didn't assume that A and B roads, as you say, in Aberdeen, are that way affected with the pavement parking. But I think I would also reiterate what was said in evidence taking from number of the councillors of the council representations, and I think the minister and members mentioned also that it's very localised to the area, and if there are problems in certain areas, i.e. the A and B roads in Aberdeen, I think that should be looked at specifically. I would certainly hope that when it comes to stage two, that amendments would include A and B roads and private roads also.
Okay. Anyone else want to come in and on those points or any others at this moment in time? John?
Just for clarification, Ms White, in relation to the A and B roads and the private roads, could you explain why you've... No, you tried to explain there in terms partly to the convener why these roads weren't included, because many of the issues, and I know your constituency very well, and I know the issues that your constituency is facing, especially with the growth in the number of flats that are being built around the Partick Roads, Byers Roads junction, and the parking problems that's now causing in the area. But do you think, in hindsight, it would have been better to include that those A and B private roads in your original bill?
I think, as I said to the convener, yes, in hindsight, I think we should have included these roads, but this is what, you know, dialogue's about, coming to give evidence. There's issues that are raised, which, Mr Wilson, you raised yourself in regards to the definition between drop curbs, crossovers, etc., which obviously made people think. So there is definitions there, and there are areas which I think should be included. You mentioned, obviously, my own constituency of Glasgow Kelvin. There has been legislation introduced by the council that there's certain flats are built that there's no cars allowed at all. So they're reacting to that type of thing in certain areas. But it wasn't just in my constituency, and you'll appreciate that. It was throughout Scotland that we received these, you know, recommendations, concerns that people had. So, yeah, I think that's why we do have the dialogue, why we do have evidence taking. If there's something that was omitted and caused enough concern, I think it should be included in stage two under amendments. I don't know if Professor Wright, is that all right?
Sorry. Just a very quick addition on this point. In the part of Britain where there is, of course, a blanket ban on footway parking in London, then A roads and B roads are included, similarly to any residential road or any other road. So.
Does that work in London, Professor Wright? Does that work well?
I used to work for London Transport, as was Transport for London, in the early 1990s. And part of my job was travelling around, in particular southwest London, because I was working on bus priority at the time. And that's a part of London with some of the highest levels of car ownership in the whole conurbation. And simply parking on the footway is not an issue. Where it is not permitted, it is not carried out. People don't do it. And that's on A roads, B roads, and unclassified roads. I should also point out that at that time in London, enforcement of parking on main roads, some main roads called red routes, was the responsibility of the police, whilst in the rest of London, the enforcement was the responsibility of decriminalised civil enforcement officers, the local authority wardens. But there was no difference in the level of enforcement between the police enforced roads and the others.
Thank you. That's very useful, Professor Rye. Stuart Stevenson, please.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to pursue the issue of definitions, and perhaps since we're talking about the definition that is relied on right at the top of the Act, public roads in both up areas, with the exception of special roads, it would probably be useful to include in the interpretation section a reminder as to the legal definition of special roads, essentially motorways, but in Scotland does include 1A road, the part of the A74. But just that's a a picky definitional bit.
Is that the A74M?
It is.
Now I'm being the pedant, Mr. Stevenson. On you go.
Well, it's just for completeness, it's because it's maintained by a different company that it is separately classified from the M74. However, let's not worry about that. Moving on, I'm not clear what the way in which the bill is written, what a vehicle is. The interpretation section makes reference to motor vehicle under section 136 of the 1984 Traffic Regulations, Road Traffic Regulations Act. But motor vehicle, of course, only covers vehicles constructed for the use carriage of passengers up to a maximum weight of 2,540 kilograms. And I would imagine that the definition of vehicle, which you would desire to use in this particular bill, would be more broad-reaching, but would exclude things like pedestrian-controlled vehicles used for street cleaning and other exceptions. Would it be your intention, if this goes forward, to perhaps remove any doubt as to what vehicle means by bringing forward a definition that could make very clear what is intended?
Ms. White, do you want to make a crack at that? And then
an attempt to come back.
And maybe Professor Rye can come in after you and tell us how the London legislation worked in that regard.
Okay, thank you very much, Convener. Stuart always raises various issues, which obviously, as I said, that's what the conversation and giving the evidence is all about. You're absolutely correct about motor vehicles. That is in the definition. I wasn't too sure about the weight or how many people it would carry. But when you mentioned the fact about cleansing vehicles, I must admit, living in the Merchant City, in Glasgow city centre, I've never seen a cleansing vehicle parked up on a pavement. They've certainly used them, but it's something I think we would look at to see if there are particular exemptions. The Minister said we would have to look at definitions before they went through on the bill at stage two. So I think we would be looking at that. But to me, in my mind, it is about motor vehicles who are blocking pavements, driveways, on drop curbs that people cannot get about. You may have seen, but I certainly haven't seen these cleansing vehicles parked up on a pavement.
Well, perhaps next time you walk up the Cannon Gate in Edinburgh, you may on occasion. But also, just to make the point that because of the weight limit in the definition of motor vehicles, for example, Rolls-Royce limousines will exceed the 2,540 kilograms, which moves them into the definition under section 136 of heavy motor vehicles. So I just make the general point. I'm not trying to bottom this out just now. And I'm sure we would wish it to apply to large passenger vehicles of that character. But also, of course, not exclude goods vehicles, which are covered by other definitions. So I just think there is a lack of clarity that it would be useful to have your commitment to take that one up and pursue it.
Thank you.
Ms. White.
I accept what Stuart Stevenson said. I won't get into the impact of different cars, Rolls Royces. I don't have very many around my area. But at the same time, they do exist. And certainly I will be picking up on that point.
There's
no
many in the area that I stay in either. Professor Rye, do you want to maybe give us an indication of how London dealt with the definition issue?
I don't know the details of London legislation sufficiently to be able to say how it's dealt with the definition issue. But in responding generally to the point that Mr. Stevenson has raised, I think it's extremely important that the definitions of motor vehicle, of parking, waiting, loading, footway and so on are consistent with the existing relevant legislation that pertains in Scotland, for example, the 1984 Road Traffic Regulation Act.
Well, that neatly moves on to the second issue I have, that the bill does not directly define what parking is. I think one can glimpse what is meant by parking, but one is uncertain in that the word stop or stopping is used in relation to parking at various stages in the bill. I would suggest that probably parking is where the vehicle has stopped and the driver is no longer in the vehicle. That converts having been stopped to becoming parked. and then one might, but certainly at present, it would appear as it's presently constructed to, for example, catch people who stop in moving traffic because the definitions that are provided of parking implicitly would appear to catch that as parking and not be caught by the exclusions of what's caught. So again, I think it would be just simply be useful for the member to indicate that this, if she agrees with me, that this would be a subject that might be further considered for a more precise definition of what parking actually is, so that the underpinnings become more robust so we can take it forward.
Ms. White.
Certainly, Stuart Stevenson raises another point, which basically, obviously, the title of the bill is parking, double parking, and parking on kerbs. I go out and ask somebody what they see when they see a car parked in a kerb. They certainly wouldn't say it. It was just somebody was driving along the street, and the indication was to stop cars which are on the roads. So I'll take that point on board and have a look at it. Thank you.
Okay. Cameron Buchanan, please.
Sorry, did you want to...
Cameron.
Sorry. I was just going to ask, I've been to lots of community councils and everybody seems to be very much in favour of this. Another thing that's mentioned, which isn't covered in the bill, is the prevalence of A-boards on pavements. And they're being... I wonder if that's going to... I know, but it's people mention that as much as double parking, and it's very important. And for people like me who have a sort of a motorised vehicle, you push them out of the way and they get really ratty.
Trust you to open up another can of worms.
Thank you.
Ms. White.
I think Cameron Buchanan makes a very valid point. And obviously local councils have responsible for what you might say street furniture. And certainly with the prevalence of A-boards, and also when the good weather is in Scotland, the prevalence of table and chairs on pavements where people are sitting outside cafes and pubs, etc., is something that I get in my post bag every other day as well, and certainly have written to councils regarding that. But that comes into like local planning issues, which I know has already been mentioned. So certainly it isn't included in the bill, and I doubt if we'd be able to interpret it in the bill, but I think it'd be something we should look at with yourselves through a local government committee in regards to local councils pushing that forward, because it is very, very much something that is raised with me on numerous occasions, along with obviously the pavement parking as well.
Okay, on that point, very briefly, George Adam, first of all, please.
Thank you, Convener. I was just going to say that last week you mentioned the access panels, Sandra, earlier on, and last week we had the national body for the access panels in, and they were saying that it may be a good idea, because some of the problems that we have with drop kerbs, where they go, how it's planned in the town, is the fact that a lot of the access panels aren't consulted. They're not a statutory body. Now, I know the planning review is underway at the moment. Would you consider, at this stage, I'm just asking what you think, would you think they should be a statutory body like local community councils, you know, to actually feed into this type of information and might help in a lot of the problems that we're having locally?
It should be statutory. We're talking about local level. People want to have their say. They live in the communities. They experience these things. I think it's imperative that these, you know, local access panels should be statutory bodies, particularly when you are looking at planning issues. And I think it was Cara Hilton that raised the fact about planning. Sometimes planners build towns and never think of who's living in them or in areas, particularly, you know, people with big buggies trying to get off and on pavements, even up and down stairs. I think the more, you know, people who access that, the better it would be for everyone. So certainly I think local access panels should, you know, have statutory, the same as community councils as well.
Okay, Stuart Stevenson, please.
Just an observation, perhaps in the light of what Cameron Buchanan said, the section 136 provides a definition for invalid carriages, which are vehicles adapted for the carriage of people not exceeding a weight of 254 kilograms. And I guess in definition of vehicle, we probably would wish to exclude from the provisions of this bill. But as it presently stands, almost certainly we're catching such vehicles.
Grant. Jane Baxter, please.
If I can, I'd like to return to a comment that Professor Rye made earlier about his experience of working in London. And Professor, you said that they brought in the prohibition and the enforcement, and then people stopped parking, and that's great. that's what we'd all want to see happen in Scotland. But I'd like to know, is that because they went and parked somewhere else? Or did people stop using cars? Or did households reduce the number of cars? Because in the real world, people still need a car more often than not. I know lots of people don't have cars, but lots of families do rely on a car to get to work or to get to school or to just support the life of their families. So do you know what alternatives were provided or do people find in London because they were able to stop parking?
Professor Rye, please.
Okay. The legislation to which I'm referring in London was introduced in 1974, so before I was working there, right? So I can't really comment on how people reacted at the time that the ban was introduced. All I can say is that there were parts of London that at that time, in the 1971 census, had higher levels of car ownership than many parts of Scotland do now. So clearly, people were able to cope. Exactly how they cope, I don't think that has been documented, to be honest. So I apologise if that doesn't fully answer your question.
Forgive me for not appreciating the time scales. No. I hope I've not offended you by thinking you were working there in the 1970s. It would be really interesting to discover if there was any research done at the time or any follow-up done at that time, because it sounds like it's something that has worked. And yes, it was addressing a very big problem, possibly an even bigger problem than we've got in Scotland. So if there's things to learn, it'd be good to discover that.
We'll certainly try and get the spice to find out if there's any information in that for you, Jane. Sandra, you wanted to come back in there.
I want to come back in there. I think Professor Rye wanted to come up. Now.
You first.
Just to Jane, we couldn't find any updated evidence, but I have got the House of Common Library payment on on-street parking in England. There are some cases in there, but I believe they're pre-1974, but you certainly leave it with the clerks. There is also Lord Tope, who was actually the councillor in London Borough of Sutton in 1974, where this happened, when the pavement parking measures were introduced, and he has a number of comments and speeches on the subject, which is favourable to what basically happened. And just for the committee's information, Simon Hoare MP is actually sponsoring the second reading of the pavement parking bill in the House of Commons on the 4th of December, which is this Friday, to be ban pavement parking in areas in England and Wales as well. So there is things ongoing. So I can leave this with the clerk, which mentions the issues I've raised and also the up-and-coming debate in the House of Commons on Friday, which may be of some help how that works down.
Would be very useful, and we'll get the clerks to circulate that to all members. Professor Rye, please.
Just to briefly develop the London situation, I mean, it's important to remember that, of course, in the London legislation permits exemptions as this would, and one does see in streets in London those exemptions which are signed and marked, which allow either four wheels or two wheels of the vehicle to be parked on the footway within the marked areas. So the Minister spoke about the sort of balance between the needs of pedestrians and the needs of car owners, and I think the way that the legislation is used in London to provide exemptions in certain areas where there are very, very high parking pressures and real problems with street space shows that balance is being struck. Yeah, so I would expect that to happen here also.
John Wilson, please.
This is a follow-up to that, Convener. Professor Rye, what would you say would be the impact of public transport in London? Because we have trains, we have underground, we have buses, we have trams. We have a number of modes of transport in London that we don't have in many of the towns and cities in Scotland. We often hear the transport system. If there was a better public transport system, then people may use their car less to get about, and certainly in London, any time that I go down and speak to friends in London, they say in most days they wouldn't use a car, they would use public transport to get around.
But if they use their cars less, they're not parked, are they? Yeah. Professor Rye.
Two responses to that. I think we've got to bear in mind that in 1974, when this ban was introduced in London, the areas that I was referring to that have had higher levels of car ownership than many parts of Scotland do now, those are areas of outer London. And the public transport accessibility in areas of outer London, whilst it's perhaps not as poor as it is in lots of parts of Scotland. It's certainly nothing like one experiences in central London. In addition to that, since 1974, the inner London public transport system has been developed to a far greater extent than it was at that time. So I think that one can't say that the fact that it worked in 1974 is only because London has a better public transport system or had a better public transport system at that time.
Stuart Stevenson.
I just wonder if Professor Rye could reference the statement he's just made that higher car ownership in London. The figures I have, and this is absolutely from memory, are 34 per 100 houses in London, 45 in Glasgow and 55 in Edinburgh. Which cities had he in mind that had higher car ownership than London?
What I'm talking about is car ownership in 1971 in London compared to car ownership in Scotland now. So when the ban was introduced in London compared to when a ban might be introduced here, that was the distinction I was making.
That's helpful. Thank
and
you.
It's based on Census 2011 statistics and Census 1971 statistics, which I could forward to Mr. Stevenson if you wish. Yeah.
Okay. Can I thank you for your evidence this morning? Obviously, there's been some discussion about the current planning review panel, and I just wonder, Ms. White, if you intended to write to them about certain of the issues that have arisen.
Absolutely, convener. We have looked at, basically the review panel. There's lots of things, not just of obviously the parking bill, but obviously issues that Cameron Buchanan had raised as well. So certainly as a local MSP and an MSP who's proposing this bill, I'll be wearing two hats at that particular time to write to them. Could I just even pick up on one point, Kevin, if you don't mind, that hasn't really been mentioned? I mean, the police have said it's about clarity as well, and the police have said this bill will bring greater clarity. And when the Minister was talking about, obviously, resources for local councils, I think we really do have to bear in mind the amount of repair work that local councils have to do, not just to pavements, but underlying, electricity cables, that type of thing as well. So in a way, it's not punitive, it's educational, but I think in the long term, much more beneficial for people under the Human Rights Act to be able to get about. But also in the long term, I think it will save councils money as well.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Suspend until 15:15. Agenda item three now is a continuation of our brief inquiry into the governance arrangements for arm's length external organisations, although it's landed up a bit longer than we'd maybe hoped for. The second evidence session on 18th of November took evidence from High Life Highland and Highland Council, EDI Group and the City of Edinburgh Council, Culture NL and North Lanarkshire Council, and Bon Accord Care. Aberdeen City Council did not attend this evidence session, and we have invited the Chief Executive, the Council Leader and the relevant Council official to attend today's meeting to explain their reasons for non-attendance and to answer the questions members were not able to put to them. I welcome Councillor Jenny Laing, Leader of Aberdeen City Council, Angela Scott, Chief Executive, and Judith Proctor of Health and Social Care Integration. Can I first of all ask about the situation of the invitation and the decision not to appear in front of the committee?
Yes.
Who's going to take that on? Councillor Laing, please.
I'll take that, convener. My understanding is that the original invitation was sent to Ms. Proctor and Ms. Ross, who's the Chief Executive of Bon Accord Care. On receipt of that, I think Ms. Proctor discussed the situation with the Chief Executive about whether she was the most relevant person to attend, and also around the capacity that we had within the council to send somebody to that hearing. That discussion, the Chief Executive then spoke to me about it and said that she was minded to write and inform the committee that we didn't feel we had adequate capacity to send a council official at that point. I accepted that because obviously we've had discussions recently about the capacity we have within our health and social care team around, you may well be aware that we've been asked to take part, I think it's actually started now, it was due to start yesterday I think, a joint inspection of older people's services. We obviously discussed that at the time because we've had a fairly rigorous inspection situation in Aberdeen over the 18-month tenure of the Chief Executive, and it was discussed by all group leaders, I have to say, across the Council about our, you know, about the joint inspection, and the agreement was that we would write to the Cabinet Secretary for Health, Wellbeing and Sport and ask if that inspection could be delayed in order to allow us to concentrate on the integration agenda. The Cabinet Secretary responded saying no, she felt that the inspection had to go ahead.
Can I stop you there, Councillor Laing? Because
yes.
that inspection is a matter for the inspectors,
yes.
And it's not a matter for this committee, your communication between the Cabinet Secretary or anyone else.
What I'm trying
to get to grips with,
yes,
is a number of things here. We're looking at governance of,
yes,
ALIOs.
Yes.
One of the things is that we received a letter, or I received a letter which was passed to the clerks from Mrs. Scott, which did not only respond on behalf of the council, but responded on behalf of Bon Accord Care, an arm's length external organisation. Now, what I would like to know is why it is that it was felt that Aberdeen City Council could respond on behalf of Bon Accord Care, an arm's length external organisation.
Okay, I was putting that in context because you asked why the council had made the decision about not sending anybody. I think it's right that we put that in the context of the discussions I had with the Chief Executive were predicated by previous aspects around capacity. And I was happy for the Chief Executive to write on that basis. The Chief Executive, I think, is best placed to answer the question about the content of her letter. But, the next I realised there was an issue was when I was contacted, I think, by a journalist asking if I would be attending this committee today, because obviously that was the decision of the committee. But perhaps the Chief Executive is best to cover that aspect.
About the letter, responding on behalf of both you as the Chief Executive of the Council and Bon Accord Care.
I had a discussion with Sandra Ross, the MD of Bon Accord, about the impact of the same capacity issues as Councillor Laing has addressed. We reached the conclusion that neither of us had the capacity to support the inquiry, and the MD of Bon Accord was quite content for me to write a response on behalf of both.
In terms of the governance issues round about, even that aspect of it, an arm's length organisation, it was felt that it was okay for the council to respond on their behalf, yeah?
With the permission of the MD to do that.
Okay. In terms of after we received that letter, my understanding is that the clerks phoned Ms Proctor on at least two occasions, and your own office, Mrs Scott, on two occasions around about the invitation to appear, but did not manage to elicit any responses.
I spoke to the clerk of the committee, Mr. Cullum.
Okay, right, fine. If I could move on in terms of the governance aspects of Bon Accord Care and Aberdeen City Council's situation round about that. First of all, can I ask which committee or committees of the council Bon Accord Care's work would report to? Mrs. Scott?
Two committees of the council, the Audit Committee, the Audit and Risk Committee, and the Education and Integrated Children's Services Committee. There's also a requirement for an annual report to go to full council.
Okay. In her evidence last week, Mrs. Ross seemed to indicate that her main point of contact was the ALIO hub, which she said, if I remember rightly, that she had to report to four times a year. Is that correct?
Her main point of contact is the commissioner of the service, which currently rests with the head of older care. The ALIO hub comprises the commissioner, the lead commissioner for the service, and in addition includes finance, procurement, HR, legal representations from across the council's corporate governance directorate.
Looking at some of the committee papers, which I've had time to do during the course of this interlude, I see that on the 25th of June 2015, at the Audit, Risk and Scrutiny Committee, there was governance, ALIO governance outstanding issues, which included A, to put in place consistent reporting arrangements for the scrutiny of ALIOs, and B, to ensure that ALIOs establish risk management processes and frameworks. It also, in that report, said that ALIO governance hub performance was not consistent. That same minute went to the Education and Children's Services Committee on the 3rd of September 2015, exactly the same minute. Would that be the two main committees that would deal with these matters?
In addition to Council receiving the annual report from Bon Accord and the annual report from the Chief Social Work Officer.
So how often would reports from ALIOs, from Bon Accord Care, not necessarily the ALIO Governance Hub, go to the Audit, Risk and Scrutiny Committee and the Education and Children's Services Committee?
We've given a commitment that the minute from each ALIO hub meeting would be submitted to the Audit Committee in order for the Audit Committee to scrutinise further the minute from the ALIO hub.
And at this moment in time, according to, again, those reports, that's only a biannual meeting of that ALIO governance hub, is that correct?
To date, but we have a recommendation from Audit Scotland that we consider moving that to four times a year.
Okay, let's move on. George Adam?
Yes, thank you. I used to be a councillor as well, and I was on an arm's length organisation, but
I don't really know one accord care, so can I ask a couple of daft boy simple questions to start off with? It's basically, what is the makeup of the board, the actual board, the governance board itself? Yes.
The board is made up of a chair and four non-executive directors.
Okay. Are there no local councillors on it at all?
No. MD and the finance director of Bon Accord are also members of the board, but there was a decision by council not to place any elected members on the board of Bon Accord.
Is that not highly unusual for ALIOs? Is it not normally there's something like the democratic accountability for them as well with having elected members on the board itself?
It's a variation across the ALIOs that we have. Wasn't in the council at the time then council was making this decision, but my understanding is it was a concern around the conflict of interest and increasingly the interpretation of conflicts of interest from the councillor's code of conduct. But also it was in part about the expertise required. The four non-executives that have been appointed to the Board of Bon Accord Care, again, my understanding is were all recruited based on the relevant skills and experience and recruited through the public appointments process.
So are we saying that councillors in Aberdeen City Council aren't capable of being on the board, don't have the skill set to be able to do it? And are we also saying, because normally there has been a talk about conflict of interest when in ALIOs for councillors, but it tends to be when you're told under no circumstances you're there as a representative of the ALIO, although you are a councillor as well. So it's a case of getting individuals. So are we saying that there wasn't a skill set within Aberdeen City Councillors to actually do that?
I'm not saying that.
Fine.
Was a decision taken by councillors that we would not have councillors on there. So, as the chief executive said, it wasn't she wasn't there at the time that decision was taken. It was felt that it would be best if we had people with the correct skill sets. Councillors were involved in that selection process, or admin councillors were, because the opposition councillors chose not to take part in that selection process.
But it seems a bizarre decision from the point of view of the democratic accountability, but also the fact that you normally get a good mix. You normally get a mix in the board of the elected members and people who have that experience that you're talking about. So it seems strange when compared, I don't have the numbers in front of me, but it does seem strange kind of scenario when compared to other ALIOs across the country.
Different approach that was taken. There's, I wouldn't dispute that, but I think it was taken in a democratic way. And for those
one
reasons.
Person's different approach is one person's strange. Then
well,
one of the other things that the actual board members themselves, where are they from? Where have they been selected? You said you went through the proper process, but are they local to the northeast? Are they kind of people who have worked in the area their whole life, or are knowledgeable of the area?
Information.
You don't know if the individuals are.
I don't know if they reside in Aberdeen.
Okay. Thank you for that. We can follow up on that. John Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Just to follow up on the questions about the democratic accountability, and we've just heard there that Bon Accord doesn't have any elected members on the board. And they're not involved in the discussions on the board. How does Aberdeen Council make sure that they are held to account for the services they deliver for the public money they receive from Aberdeen City Council?
Who's going to take that on? Ms. Proctor, please.
The process has been described in terms of the governance of the organisation through the ALIO Hub, through the annual report to full council and to the ALIO Hub reporting to the various committees of the council. In addition to that, we have regular reporting from Bon Accord Care in terms of their performance and delivery against their key performance indicators. We get weekly statistics from Bon Accord Care in terms of what they're delivering, their number of service users. We have information from them in regard to ongoing issues of complaints, comments, compliments that they're getting. I attend their board meetings, or one of my senior managers attends their board meetings, and we also have regular contact with them through our contracts and commissioning team in terms of delivery against their contract.
Can I just clarify, in what capacity do you attend, or your representative attend, the board meeting?
Of course, as an observer, not as a member of the board.
You have full speaking rights at that board meeting?
I do, yes.
But you don't have voting rights?
I don't vote.
You don't vote, right. And you indicate that the ALIO Hub there provides weekly statistics to yourself?
Bonacord Care provide weekly statistics to us, not the ALIO Hub.
So explain the difference between the ALIO Hub and Bonacord.
The ALIO Hub... Well, your first question was around holding to account. And then from a governance perspective...
Holding to account from holding, a democratically elected
absolutely.
Member's perspective.
Yeah. So what are we holding Bonacord to account for? It's this management of its risk and its management of performance. The ALIO Hub has been designed to make sure that we have capability in that ALIO Hub that can give the audit committee, the primary committee within the council, the democratic committee, the ALIO Hub on behalf of the audit committee can look at the system of risk management which Bonacord has in place. That's a primary function of the audit committee of the council. So the ALIO Hub gives a view to the audit committee around Bonacord's systems of risk management that are in place. In addition, the ALIO Hub also scrutinises, supported by the commissioning team, the performance of Bonacord. And again, the reports of those are submitted to the Audit Committee and the Service Committee. So we are providing the two committees within the Council evidence around the management of risk and the management of performance. In addition, our own internal audit function have been commissioned with doing a, because of the number of ALIOs that we have, doing a rotation of looking at the ALIOs. The findings of our internal audit are submitted to both our audit committee and our service committee. And in addition, the Care Inspector, as an external assurance body, is providing assurance too. And those reports from the Care Inspector are equally submitted to the service committee. So our two primary service committees are provided with the information to allow them to hold Bonacord to account. The ALIO Hub is largely populated with officers with appropriate expertise. So we have a finance lead, HR lead, a risk lead, a legal risk, and the commissioning from there. All of that information is triangulated. It's all joined together because it tells a kind of cohesive story about the performance of that organisation. And we're presenting that information back into our respective service committees, which is where the elected members sit on.
Is that largely populated by officers or exclusively populated by officers?
At this stage, as we've been creating the ALIO Hub to date, the ALIO Hub has been comprised of officers. That's consistent with the recommendation, as I understand it, to create a stakeholder group, which said the stakeholder group should comprise officers, commissioners, and elected members. We were, and so the complexity
at this point in time, it's only officers.
But okay. The reports from that are submitted into our committees.
John Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for that follow-up question. So that's where I was going to take this question as well, because it seems surprising, and for someone like myself, and having been an elected member to make that declaration in the past, that it sounds as though the information is provided to the ALIO Hub, and then the ALIO Hub, which is made up of officers and commissioning officers, then sift or potentially sift the information that is then provided to the democratically elected members of the council to actually read the reports that are then delivered to them from the ALIO Hub. Is that the situation?
Assurance point of view, there are three layers of assurance on any issue within the council, whether it's the arm's length structure or our primary services. I provide that assurance through three levels: management assurance, internal assurance through internal audit, and external assurance. So we've been very consistent in the ALOs in that we are providing, the ALOs providing that management assurance, council is commissioning its own internal audit to provide assurance, and then the care inspector. That's wholly consistent with the assurance that we provide on all other service activity across the council.
One of the explanations we've been given for the establishment of ALIOs by local authorities is to save costs to the local authority, to get services delivered because of the cost savings that could be made, because of the charitable arrangements that could be set up. But what I'd be interested in to find out is what additional systems have been put in place by particularly Aberdeen, given we're looking at Aberdeen and you've got the ALIO Hub,
additional costs of the systems that have been put in place to monitor the delivery of services. Because if the argument, general argument, is setting up ALIOs can actually bring better value to the public pound, to local authorities, if we are setting up very complicated monitoring systems that involve senior staff of the council to monitor the service delivery, was that the same type of monitoring system that was put in place prior to it being the services being transferred to ALIO?
Who's doing that one? Ms. Scott?
I'll attempt to answer that. I mean, all I can explain is under my watch how I want our group structure to operate, because it's complex, and that's the nature of service delivery in local government. So I have tier one, I have four tier one ALIOs, have a volume of tier two that are smaller. In addition to that, I will have the integrated joint board. So in the midst of all of that, I need to make sure that the scrutiny arrangements support all of that. Within the ALIO hub, there was a clear business case that was submitted to council that set out, just as you've described, a number of benefits that were anticipated. For me, for me, the primary initial objective for me in getting the ALIO hub created was to make sure that actually we were providing that assurance back into the democratic system in the way that you've been scrutinising. That was objective number one for me. And also to make sure I'd inherited a number of ALIOs in my group structure, to make sure that we were given all of the ALIOs, which is quite extensive in Aberdeen City Council, that we were being consistent in our scrutiny of all ALIOs. And I wasn't persuaded that we had that in place. So my primary objective has been to get the ALIO hub set up and functioning for all of that, both the tier one and the tier two. And the second objective for me then is to go back to the business case and make sure that we are tracking the benefits that were set out in that business case to council, of which council then made the decision to move to an ALIO structure. And so there has to be a work stream and a focus within the ALIO hub to make sure that we are tracking the benefits that we set out to council to support that. That's the next phase of the ALIO hub to get to move into that space.
Thank you for that explanation, Ms. Scott. But my initial point was ALIOs were supposed to have been established to save money to local authorities and value for the public pound. Under the previous system, before ALIOs would have been set up, my understanding would have been that the delivery of a service would have been the responsibility either of head of that service, who would have reported to a director, who would have then reported to the relevant council committees in relation to the performance delivery of the services being delivered by that local authority. What I'm now concerned about is the example that you've given, where the ALIO hub has now set up a whole new structure, or it sounds like a whole new structure, to actually monitor the delivery of the services by the ALIOs, which then, as I described, it's either sifts or filters information that then goes before elected members at the audit committee or other committees of the council, or indeed the full council when it comes to reporting on the delivery of those services. So how has that been costed in relation to Aberdeen City Council's good practice and saving public pound in relation to transferring services to ALIOs?
Mrs. Scott.
The ALIO hub isn't a different structure. It's largely comprised of officials and officers within the corporate governance directorate whose primary role is to support the governance of the organisation. So all we're doing is actually, and if you go back when those services were in-house, finance colleagues, legal colleagues, HR colleagues would be supporting the service in its scrutiny and its challenge of the services when they were in-house. I think there's a strength in the approach that we're devising through the ALIO hub that I would actually like to see spread and kind of deeper scrutiny of the services that are within the council, because the strength for the ALIO hub is that now we're joining all the information together in order to make sure that, I guess, we're triangulating all of that information. So no longer looking at performance through one lens, we're looking at the outcomes that are being achieved versus the financial performance versus the staff issues that are coming. So there's a strength for me in bringing all of that together. There's not an additional cost to the council in having created the ALU hub. It's simply it will be a quarterly meeting led by our Director of Corporate Governance, where officers are bringing all the information that's coming into the council from Bon Accord and scrutinising that information. So there's not an additional cost associated with the ALU hub. I guess the second part of your question is about the cost of setting up Bon Accord and it having its own management structure. And I don't know if Ms. Ross got into any of the detail for that, but clearly there's a management structure that's been put in place to support that. That's a cost. That was a cost when the service was in house as well. So I'm not sure what more I can add to the question that you've asked.
Okay, we'll take Jane Baxter now, please.
I was going to ask about performance. It sounds like you have structures in place to gather and examine a lot of performance information. Has there ever been occasion when the council's had to take action based on concerns it's got about performance? Has there ever had to be any sanctions or any withdrawal of contracts? Are you satisfied that the performance is good and continuing to improve?
Who's going to take that on? Ms. Proctor?
Clarify whether the question is specific to Bon Accord Care or more generally.
I think we'll just leave it with Bon Accord Care because that's what we talked about last time.
Yeah. We've applied no sanctions.
Okay, thank you. And I'll just ask the same question as I asked everybody else the last time as well, just to be consistent. Does Bon Accord Care pay the living wage?
Yes.
And fully funded through the council to do that?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. John?
Thank you, Convener. Can I go back to the first question that has been raised by Jane Baxter, and that is we specify, concentrate on Bon Accord Care. Has there been any occasion when Aberdeen City Council has withheld funding from any of the ALUs currently under its funding regime?
Councillor Laing.
Thank you. Yes, I think in our survey that we put back, we indicated that, but it was not Bon Accord Care. It was one of our other ALUs.
I'm widening it out because I want to examine the issue of the suspension of funding to an ALU and what that...
It was a delayed funding because they had not produced the business plan that we had expected, so they were given additional time in which to do that.
Right. There was delayed funding because of additional time to produce a business plan. What were the practical implications of that in relation to funding being provided? Because my understanding is the overwhelming majority of the funding that any ALIO would receive from a local authority would be for staff costs. If you delay making funding to an ALIO, did that have any implications on staff being paid by that ALIO?
Not aware that it did, no, because the time delay was so short.
What was the time delay?
It was a couple of weeks.
Right, and there was no financial issues with that ALIO in relation to
I'm not aware that there were, no.
Right. I would be grateful if you could check that out because I'm keen to know if local authorities are taking action against ALIOs and withholding funding, then that could potentially have a knock-on effect in terms of operational delivery of the services by that ALIO if local authorities were so minded to take that action.
I accept that, and we can check that. The other thing I'd like to point out, it was before we had the governance hub that took place. It is not since then.
Right, thank you.
I'd like to move back to Bon Accord Care. And having looked at the Audit, Risk and Scrutiny and Education and Children's Services Committee, nowhere could I find key performance indicators. How do elected members get the key performance indicators from Bon Accord Care about the delivery of service to what is some of the most vulnerable folk in the city?
The annual report that Bon Accord Care provide,
So what you're saying to me, Ms. Proctor, is that the only opportunity for elected members to scrutinise key performance indicators would be through the annual report and the questioning session around about the annual report.
The ALIO Hub will also look at areas of high risk and at the risk register of...
I'm asking about elected member scrutiny. Okay. I'm not asking about the ALIO Hub. What you're saying to me is at this moment, as it stands, the only way that elected members can look at key performance indicators round about the care delivery that Bonaccord Care is carrying out is at the time of the annual report. Is that correct?
And that would be correct, and that would be the same with all our external providers.
So. I understand in terms of the other external providers, but what we are talking about here is some very vulnerable, often at great risk people. And, you know, from my perspective, if I was an elected member with a situation where an ALIO was dealing with care, I would be wanting to see key performance indicators on a much more regular basis. Because after all, the buck stops with the elected members. But as it stands, that's only once a year.
All our providers are providing services to people that are vulnerable. So key performance indicators in terms of vulnerable people and our performance against them as a social work department are reported regularly to Education and Children's Services, which is the parent committee for adult services, until such time as the integrated joint board goes live in April.
So I looked at the Education and Children's Services Committee agenda from the 3rd of September 2015. And as I say, in terms of adult care there, what we had is the same minute about the ALIO Governance Hub that went to the Audit, Risk and Scrutiny Committee, and a report on the Adult Service Performance Report, which didn't really give me any key performance indicators at all. So when was the last time that key performance indicators round about social care aspects were reported to a committee of the council?
The performance report that goes to committee are the KPIs for social care.
So that very brief set of graphs was the KPIs that go to the committee. That's it.
Those are the performance indicators for adult social care.
Right, okay.
Just in recognition that there are a whole load of other commissioners, commission bodies that the council uses, and so the report to council is reflecting the totality of the outcomes that we're achieving from all of our providers, Bonaccord being one.
So at the very beginning of that report, there is the objectives of ensuring that people at risk are protected, people are effectively supported within their families and communities, people fully participate in individual service planning, review and delivery, well-being is promoted in all care groups, and that our resources are managed effectively and our organisation is effective. Do you think those KPIs and the minute from the ALIO Hub actually allow you to adhere to those principles and to scrutinise to make sure that that's happening? Councillor Laing.
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
First? Absolutely, I can repeat the question, and I'll go right back to the start. Mm-hmm. Because at the Adult Service Performance Report, the beginning of it, it says the objectives are to ensure that people at risk are protected, people are effectively supported within their families and communities, people fully participate in individual service planning, review and delivery, well-being is promoted in all care groups, that our resources are managed effectively and our organisation is effective. Do you think that the minutes from the ALIO Governance Hub and the brief report on those KPIs actually allow elected members to scrutinise properly to make sure that those objectives are being achieved, particularly in terms of the service delivery by Bonaccord Care?
Well, what I would say is it's up to the members of that committee, if they're unhappy with that, the reports that they get, to instruct officers to bring additional information. That's what I would say. What I, As far as the KPIs go, you've obviously looked at the committees that we've talked about that are dealing with the ALIOs now. But I think from what we've heard from Ms. Proctor and Mrs. Scott is that the performance that we're reporting to committee is for all services that the council is providing in that relation. And that would be no different if we were operating without an ALIO. The reporting information would be the same, apart from we wouldn't have the governance hub aspect to it, and it probably wouldn't be appearing in front of Audit and Risk Committee. It would just be coming to the service committees. So I actually think that we've probably got a couple of layers in there that we would not have if the services were being provided directly by the council as opposed to an ALIO. And my understanding is that is the information that we have reported on for some considerable time, and it would be up to elected members if they required additional information to request that.
So you've got more layers than you had previously, which follows on from what Mr. Wilson said earlier. But looking at the information that is being given to councillors, that seems to be much, much less than the performance indicators that were given to councillors when I was a member of Aberdeen City Council.
Well, we would have to look back the records on that. The other aspect that I would say is that Audit Scrutiny and Risk Committee is chaired up by opposition member, yeah, and the vice chair is an opposition member. So I would have thought if there was unhappiness, from elected members regarding that, then that would be brought to the fore.
In terms of,
I'm
sorry,
committee.
But I'm speaking now, Councillor Laing. In terms of the social care and well-being objectives, which I've read out and I'm not going to read again, I would have thought that there would have been another body other than the Audit, Scrutiny and Risk Committee looking at that. And that seems to be, at the moment, the Education and Children's Services Committee. And from what I can see, there's not that much information there. Can I move on to the aspect of savings? Because obviously one of the things which others have given evidence on is the expected savings from moving to an ALIO situation. And there are those savings and non-domestic rates and VAT and other things. Could you give us an indication of how much saving Aberdeen City Council has made from moving from in-house to the ALIO Bon Accord Care? Who's going to answer?
The business case that went to Aberdeen City Council indicated savings within 5 years. Obviously, we're just 18 months into the operation of Bon Accord Care.
So what is the saving thus far?
We're not looking at savings year on year, okay, but within the broad delivery of that five-year plan. Would it
be correct that as the shift over took place, the budget for the first year was £23 million from the council to Bon Accord Care, thereby? £23 million, thereby?
Can I just get some clarification about the remit of, is it an investigation into Bon Accord Care?
No, it's an investigation into arm's length external organisations.
Well, what I would say is, convener, there was a business case put forward which was agreed by council. I take on board that ALIOs are set up in order to make savings, but that is not the whole point of the business case that came before us. There were various other aspects to that, which we can obviously send to committee members so they can see what the reasoning was behind that.
We'd appreciate that, yeah, Councillor Laing. But what we have tried to do with all of the folk who have come in front of us is to establish if any savings have actually been made by moving from an in-house service to an ALIO. Most folks have been able to point that out. The thing is as well that during the interlude, it has given some of us the time to go and have a look
other things round about that. Now, my understanding is, and you can set the record straight by writing to us, that the original budget was £23 million. That was actually raised to £24 million. There was a million pound uplift. That has risen to £25.5 million and is now, I think, going to rise even further to £26.4 million. And yet, that's quite an uplift, it has to be said. And yet it seems that much more delivery of service is going to other providers than Bonaccord Care in percentage terms. Would that be the case, or do you want to write to us about that?
Just a point of clarification around the increases. As was asked earlier about whether we provide the living wage, what was important to us when we set up Bonaccord Care was that the terms and conditions that staff received were the same as if they had remained in-house. As a result of that, we've obviously had pay increases have occurred, and that has obviously led to increased amounts going to Bonaccord Care in relation to that, and terms and conditions and levels of service. So I think we need to bear that in mind, and perhaps it would be best if we wrote to the committee on that basis so that you have an understanding of where those amounts have come from, rather than, you know, getting into it today.
That would be extremely useful. I wonder if you could also write to the committee round about the external funding or external income aspect of the business case as well, because I think that the business case for this was largely predicated in bringing in additional income. Would I be correct in that?
I think it was part of it was around the right to trade and to also reinvest. That was within the business case, yes.
And my understanding is that that will reach 100,000 in 2019, but maybe you can clarify that for us in writing too, please.
I take it is just Bonaccord Care you want just clarification Bonaccord, on and just not any care. Of the other ALIOs that we deal
no,
with?
No, we were just dealing with Bonaccord Care. We were trying to match one ALIO with one council when we set out to to do this. Mr. Wilson, please.
As a follow-up to that, convener, I'd be grateful when we did receive evidence from Ms. Ross. Ms. Ross was asked about the pension liabilities of Bonaccord, and basically she admitted and it's on the record that Bonaccord Care was an admitted body into the pension scheme, but indicated that the pension deficit had increased over the period. The last 2 years or the last 18 months of the operational period, and would ask the council if anything happened to Bonaccord Care. I'm assuming that the council would take back in-house those services, and do you monitor the liabilities of any of the ALIOs in the event that the council would have to step in and deliver these services if the ALIO was to, for whatever reason, have their funding withdrawn or could no longer operate, or the board felt they could no longer operate?
Mrs. Scott, please.
Contract allows the council to intervene in the event of a significant failure in Bonaccord. The council has the right under the contract to bring those services back in. And of course, if you know, if anything did happen, we would of course do that. In terms of the pension liability, again, my understanding of the contract is that we would honour that. The pension deficit, I mean, again, for all admitted bodies, that, you know, there's a whole governance that sits around the North East Pension Fund, and Bonaccord's been admitted into that to that pension fund. We consistently look at all of the council's financial exposure, whether that's as a consequence of pension deficits or whether it's a consequence of giving guarantees to any organisation. So we are, and that's the role of our Section 95, is to monitor the council's constant exposure to those things that are clearly on the balance sheet, but also those things where we are giving guarantees.
And I can assume from that answer, Ms. Scott, that includes any ALIOs that are operating under the funding regime from the council.
Yes.
City Council. That's right. Thank you.
The other ALIOs that we have looked at, and we selected
carefully. One was a cultural allele, the other a leisure one, and one a property one. Obviously, slightly different in terms of Bonacord care, with the care service aspect, particularly when it comes to health and social care integration. Can I ask how that will be dealt with, and if integration was written into the original contract, is it going to be achievable to complete integration with an allele dealing with care services? Ms. Proctor?
I'm not sure I fully understand your question.
Well, obviously, you're moving to health and social care integration.
Yes.
With, I think, if memory serves me well, Bonacord care would account for about 10% thereby of your joint integration budget. Would I be right in that?
Yes, that'd be around
about. So in terms of directing Bonacord care into fulfilling all of the integration that will be required between the health service and care services, has the contract been set out so that that causes no difficulty whatsoever? And in terms of fitting everything together, including governance, how is that going to work?
We're online to achieve everything that we need to achieve in order to go live as a partnership by the 1st of April next year, the required date. Bonacord Care obviously are a key delivery partner to what we're doing. They deliver services on behalf of Aberdeen City Council currently. They will deliver services under the direction of the Integrated Joint Board in future. And we're doing some work within our organisation in order to look at contractual assurance so that we're very, very clear about the contractual obligations to Bonacord Care that sit between the IJB and Aberdeen City Council.
And you think you've got the flexibility in the contract to be able to fulfil all aspects of integration with Bonacord Care still in place?
Our delivery of integration, I don't think, is contingent on the Bonacord Care contract.
Okay. One of the things which has been suggested to me is certain things were transferred to Bonacord Care, certain things were left in-house. Some things were split between Bonacord Care and Aberdeen City Council. Would that be correct?
I wasn't working in Aberdeen at the time that the decision was made on which services would be given to Bonacord Care, so I'm not entirely sure which ones those would have been that would have been split.
In terms of occupational therapy, where does that lie at this moment between the two, Council and Bonacord Care?
Occupational therapy sits across Bonacord Care. There are aspects of occupational therapy delivered within that. We have some occupational therapists who work within the wellbeing team, and we also have occupational therapy in NHS services.
It's been suggested that at this moment in time, some folk have got three OTs and some folk have got zero OTs. Would that be the case? And how can the ALEO contract be dealt with to ensure that that folk get OTs, an OT each rather than the three OTs that may be the case at the moment? Is that a flaw in contract, or is that just a flaw in the system at this moment in time?
I would certainly be very interested in evidence around people having more OTs than they require.
I think I can provide you that.
That would be helpful. Obviously, okay. We would be looking to be set up so that people have the services required from the right person.
Okay. Can I thank you very much for your evidence today? Obviously, we've asked for a number of things which we would appreciate in writing. There may be more, and I suspend this meeting and we move into private session.